Hello and welcome to the Ladybug Laboratory podcast. I'm your host, Lily, and this is a podcast all about knitting and crafting. You can find me on Instagram as ladybug.lily, on Ravelry as ladybuglily. There is a Ravelry group for the podcast called the Ladybug Laboratory podcast group, and that is where you can find all the show notes, any knit-alongs that are mentioned, and there's a questions thread. If you have any suggestions for topics to talk about, today I am drinking blueberry black tea in my Let It Snow mug with its amazing snowman that says Believe. It is quite warm out today, but quite frankly, I'm drinking warm tea anyway because it makes me happy. We do have a knit-along currently going on in the Ravelry group. It is called the Selfish Make-Along. It's a year-long cowl, and there are prizes for the chatter thread and the finished objects thread. Please go ahead and contribute to both of those. It may or may not be called the Selfish Make-Along. That's like a provisionary title, if you will, depending on how episode A's reaction went. So, you'll know when you go to the group. This is episode 17B. Today is Saturday, April 1st, and this should ideally be going live on Wednesday, April 12th. Our segments today are some Works in Progress, or UFOs, Maker of the Month, a Help segment talking about some soap, and then finally a little bit of prattle about clutter and crafting and all of that. So let's get started. For Works in Progress, I'm going to start with the few Works in Progress that you may have seen before. So, I'm going to start with my Yarnia knit-along. This is living in my studio in the green bicycle bag, which I absolutely love and you have not seen before, but look! It has tiny cats on the back of the bicycle. I love it. Studio in the green, they have 4 yarn guides in the side of their medium bags, which are snappable, so you can get your yarn out. And there's a pocket in the middle. So, this is my Yarnia knit-along. This is the pattern Yarn Quest 2017 Heroes of Yarnia RPG Mystery Knit-Along by Tanya Richter. And I am making it with Shalimar Yarns Breathless, which is a 75-15-10 superwash cashmere and silk. And the colors are Loden, which is the green, and Oyster, which is the white. So if you've seen this before, this is a dice rolling game. You play a character. My character is Leona Everly. And I've made it all the way through. I made it out of a particular dungeon. And this is a paid for pattern, so I don't really want to give too much away. But when you last spoke to me, I was right here where this moon progress keeper is, and this is from Lone Larch Studios. So I made this amazing dragon! And that's where I am right now. The stitch markers that I'm using are from Selkie Studio Company, the small size, and they are magnetic. They're bronze with these little magnetic beads. This is double knitting. So we've got the other side. It's completely reversible. And I love it! I'm a little bit over halfway through, and I'm still working on my first ball of yarn. It did call for 2 balls in each color, but I don't know if I'm going to use them. So we'll see. I am knitting these on size 2.5, US 2.5, 3mm needles. These are Addy Turbos sock crockets. And yeah, I think that's about all I have to say about these. I'm really, really enjoying this pattern. It is definitely an indulgent pattern for me because I don't know that I would ever even wear this, but I'm just loving the process. I started it at the beginning of the year and it really rekindled my love of knitting and my enjoyment. I can't say enough good things about it. The knit-along did end. But they do have several other knit-alongs throughout the year. Tanya Richter decided to start a whole campaign of it. So if you're interested, please, 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 I cannot speak highly enough about it. So my next knit along is another one that you've seen, and these are my BB8 socks. I'm using the smooth operator sock pattern, so there wasn't really any use of me putting them on sock blockers because there's no heel yet. But the cuffs, toes, and eventually the heels are in Knit Picks Stroll, which is a 75-25 superwash merino in the cork colorway. By the way, that's where my show notes are, so I'm sorry if I keep looking down. And then the self-striping in the middle is Mint Rain Yarns in their BB8 colorway. The purple is where the heel is going to go. So these are for my husband. And last time that you saw them, I had finished the first sock and I had started the second sock. These are toe up, so I just did a very basic wedge toe. My cuffs are just a 1x1 rib with Jenny's surprisingly stretchy bind off. And last time you saw it, I was just about to put in the heel. So I put in the heel, waist yarn, and then I finished up the second sock. I have no idea when I'm actually going to get these done, because quite frankly, my vanilla socks for me are to just go, and you can't just go when you're doing the heel. So eventually I'll finish these, but for now they're just kind of sitting there. And I knit those on US size 2, which is a 2.75 millimeter needle. And this progress keeper is from the Crafty Cat Studios Etsy shop. And the next project that I have is living in another studio in the green project bag. This is their sock size instead of their shawl size, which means there's only one yarn guide on each side, but there's still a pocket in the middle. And these are the last one that you've seen in the past. This is my Sweet Grass socks, and I'm using the Sweet Nuttons pattern by Adrian Fong. It is a free pattern on Ravelry, and it was part of Sock Madness 10. The yarn is Knit Picks Stroll Tonal in the Pond colorway. Here they are on the sock blockers. They've got this beautiful rib down the side, and I'll just turn it so you can see the back end have this beading pattern, which I love. I absolutely love this. And I'm just using some basic beads. Last time that you saw this, I had just finished the heel flap, but I had not yet, I had picked up the gusset, but I hadn't started it. So the gusset has patterning on these. I don't know if you can see that. But, so I'm still working on the gusset, but I'm really happy with these. Oh, sorry that it's clicking. The stitch markers, I got, these are Ladybug stitch markers. There we go. That I got from Susan of the One More Row podcast. And the needles are Addy Turbo Sock Rockets in the, oh gosh, I think they're US ones, which would be a 2 millimeter sock needle, I think. So yeah, oh, and these are new sock blockers, by the way. They have this cat in them. I got them at Stitches West, and I really, really love them. So yeah, my next work in progress is living in my Time for Tea project bag, which is from Front Range Bags. And these are pretty amazing. They've got, these are actually pockets on the outside. And then once you open it up, give me 1 second to get my project out. There are three small fabric pockets on one side, and on the other side, there's a zipper pocket. So these are definitely some great bags. This is the medium sized bag. And what I have here is the sweater that I have been working on. And this is, if you remember last time I talked about my Stash Love segment, this is what I've been making with that Swan's Island yarn. Here it is. It's beautiful. I love it. I absolutely love the way that it's working up. So this is the looking back sweater, which I am modifying, and I ran through the custom fit program. Looking back is by Hohe Locatelli, and custom fit is by Amy Herzog. This is the front, and it's actually going to button up the back and be reversible. So I'll talk a lot more about how I modified this, but the looking back pattern is top down. Custom fit is always seamed bottom up. And the reason I decided to custom fit it is because I wanted set in sleeves and I wanted it seamed because that looks a lot better on me. So when I got the numbers back from custom fit, I basically reversed them and like cast on at the shoulders instead of binding off and decreased when I should have increased. And then I just kind of ad-libbed incorporating this pattern into the increases and decreases. So that's the front. I finished the front. I've also finished two back pieces. I promise these are not this small. They're like, there we go. But I finished two back pieces, and I did something very similar, except that I switched the numbers to have a button band down the middle. So I took out an inch worth and then I divided it in half. And I also incorporated a slight V-neck into this. So there's gonna be a little bit of a V in the back, but then when I flip it around, it'll be a nice short V-neck. Instead of having it usually on the back of the custom fit sweaters, it's straight across. So I did that for my back pieces, and then I made the sleeves. So I have finished both sleeves. I knit the sleeves two at a time, and they have this sleeve pattern, again, which is from the looking back pattern. And I've started seaming the first sleeve. This is what it looks like. I started seaming it, at which point I realized that I completely forgot to block the sleeve pieces. So I don't know if I'm going to unseam it and block it, or if I'm just going to try and block it while it's already seamed. I'm not really 100% sure, but I definitely need to block it because it's not tight enough for it to just work while I'm wearing it. But yeah, so I have to seam up the sleeves. I did a tubular bind off, by the way. And this is just a 1x1 rib, twisted rib. So I have to seam up the sleeves and seam up the sides and set them in, and then knit the button band and the collar. And I'll be done. So for those, I am working on US 8s, which is a 5mm needle. I'm using my Knit Picks needles. And the yarn is this Swan's Island washable DK, which is merino wool. It's handcrafted. And I really, really, really am so happy with it. I cannot wait to have this sweater. It's going to be versatile. I can have the lace panel in the front, or I can turn it around and have the lace panel in the back and have it button up like a cardigan. And I am enjoying working on it. I'm enjoying everything about it. And I love the yarn. I love how the yarn just goes through my fingers. I can't wait to have it done, but at the same time, I don't want to finish working with this yarn, so yeah. And I know that I will not be able to wear it at least until next year because it's already way too warm for a fingering weight knit sweater, let alone a DK. But I think I'm just going to finish it to have it off the needles, and also because I'm trying to knit 5 sweaters this year. 4 of which will be adult sized, and I'll knit 1 baby sweater, but I don't want to have more than 1 sweater on the go at once, so I'm going to finish this, and then I'll start another, well, top. I guess it doesn't have to be a sweater, but yeah! So I'm really, really enjoying that. My next work in progress, is living in this Ladybug project bag by Bling Your String. Oops. linear string. And this was a gift from Carolyn of the Next Beautiful Thing podcast. And fittingly, what's in here is my snowfall shawl. And the pattern that I'm using is Frau Hall, I think, by Frau Hall by Lotta Groger. It's German, I'm not 100% sure if I got that right. I am knitting this on US 5 3.75 millimeter Hiya Sharps. This is my first time using Hiya Sharps. And this is a lacy shawl that is designed to mimic snowflakes. My goodness. So this pattern was a gift also from Carolyn of the Next Beautiful Thing podcast. And it was a gift that meant a lot to me. Because I had made some joke about, she said, oh, we were doing a mini skein swap. And she said, oh, is there anything that you want from Canada? And I said, oh, I want snow. And she gifted me this pattern, which was designed after snow. And I had already bought this yarn to make a white shawl because there's formal events that I attend where you can only wear white. And it was perfect. I couldn't have asked for anything better. So I'm using Black Trillium Fiber Studio Silk and Lace, which is an 85% superwash merino and a 15% silk blend. I'm making the large size of this, so I actually have quite a ways to go. I'm repeating a lot of the charts because it's a large size. But I'm really, really enjoying this. And also, this is the first time that I am using a beetle to put beads on my project. And I definitely, definitely recommend the beetle. I also got one of those bead spinners to load the beetle, which maybe I'll record and put a little snippet of if people are interested in. But yeah, this is the yarn that I'm using, and these are the beads. They actually blend a little bit better than that. The light is really making the beads look more white than they are. But this is a natural undyed yarn. And this, lace weight is a little bit thin for me. But, you know, I had already got this and I wanted to use lace weight anyway. And I am really enjoying this pattern, but I'm doing it in like little chunks. So I'll get, you know, an urge to do it and I'll do, you know, a chart, and then I'll set it aside for a while. But I'm really enjoying this pattern, so thank you so much, Carolyn. I cannot tell you how much this means to me. Alright, so the next work in progress I have is living in my... Oh, and I forgot to say that the stitch markers that were on this were from Silky Studio. Yeah, I had a lot of stitch markers on there, but they were all from Silky Studio on Etsy. And so my next work in progress is living in my lone larch to-go bag. So I literally knit on it while I'm walking. And I'm using 9-inch circs for this one. These are US 1.5s or 2.5 millimeter. These are 9-inch circs. This is the first time I've used 9-inch circs, and a lot of people always talk about how they're faster. I don't know that they're actually faster for me because I feel like I have to adjust the yarn constantly and I end up wasting time, but I'm not 100% sure. I'm going to give it a chance for this pair of socks. But these are also for my husband. I am doing the smooth operator sock pattern, but I forgot to bring waist yarn and I was out when I needed to put the heel in, so I just pulled from the other end of the ball. So you can't actually tell that it's there, but this is a progress keeper that I'm using to mark where the waist yarn is. And the progress keeper is from Wicked You Fiber Arts. And it came with one of the skeins that I purchased. So this is the smooth operator sock pattern by Susan B. Anderson. The same as with my BB8 socks. And I'm making these for my husband, and this is the Into the World Pokoku sock in its resist, which is a 75% superwash merino, 25% nylon, and it is resist dyed in the Cap'n Tight Pants colorway, which if you have ever watched Firefly, you know Cap'n Tight Pants is Kaylee's name for Mal when they're at the shindig, the mighty fine shindig, and feel like I use my husband as an excuse to buy nerdy yarns that I really like that I know I would never wear. Because he loves nothing better than hand-knit socks. And he's also nerdy. And he doesn't appreciate the yarns as much as I do. But I love them. And I love knitting with them. So that's what that is. I'm enjoying this project so far. So I'm calling those my cat and tight socks. socks. And I have two more works in progress. So this one is something that I am doing. And I'm using two different yarns in this project. So the first one I'm using is Barocco Folio, which is a 65% superfine alpaca and 35% rayon. This is it. It comes in a 50 gram ball. And the other one is Kid Mohair Classic, which is 80% kid mohair and 20% nylon. And this one I got from Eva Christie. Woof! This one I got from Eva Christie. And I won it in her Sontag along. So thank you, Eva. And I decided to hold them double. I am knitting this on my Knit Picks Interchangeable US7, which is a 4.5 millimeter needle. And the pattern that I'm using is That Nice Stitch by Susan Ashcroft. And it's a cowl that is knit on the bias. And it's got this patterning in it. So I'm knitting these together. It is very, very soft because it's alpaca and mohair, and it sort of takes a little bit of the crinkle out of the mohair, but adds the halo, or keeps the halo. And I really, really like how it's coming out. I'm planning to just keep going until I run out of yarn, basically. I'm gonna have slightly more yardage of the mohair than of the alpaca, but not a lot. I'm basically gonna run out of the ball of alpaca and have a tiny bit of mohair left. This did call for a provisional cast on, which I just picked out, because I was going to graft it, but I decided that instead I would like to do it buttoned. So I picked out the provisional cast on, and I think I'm just going to make, I can't decide if I'm going to make the buttonholes or the button band on this side, but, yeah, I've used just over half of the ball, and it goes around my neck slightly more than once. It's like from here to here, maybe once and a half. I'm just gonna go until it's finished, so I figure by the end it could go tightly around my neck maybe three or four times, and loosely probably twice, and then since it's buttoned I'll be able to use it as a scarf as well. This is blowing out a little bit. There, that's more true to color, but this way you can see the stitch. Yeah, my main thing that I don't like about cowls is that I have to pull them over my head. So I figure if I'm buttoning it, that should take that step away. So yeah, that is living in my Mama Made Waffles project bag, which is my foxes. And the last work in progress that I have for today is living in my third Studio in the Green project bag, which has my kitties on it. And this is my scrap blanket. So, when you last saw it, I was working on the right hand edging, and I had done this one on the bottom, this purple, and this one, which is one of my opal minis, and this gray. So, I did this, which is a Miss Babs Yummy 2-ply, and that is the main color from my grandmother's sweater. And then I did this one, which I'm pretty sure is from Carolyn of the Next Beautiful Thing podcast, and it's called Shamrock Spackle. Here we go. And I did this sort of neon orangey yellow one, and that is from my friend Danielle, who does this Silky Studio stitch marker company on Etsy. And I did this one, which is from Jessamine of the Knitted Towel podcast, and she talked about how she did she used little like nuggets of yarn, and she had a little bit left over of different yarns and wanted to know if anybody else did, so I said sure, and she sent them on over to me. It's beautiful. And then I have this purple one, which is like a light purple. And this is from Susan of the One More Row podcast. And then finally, I have this one, which is one of my Opal minis. A couple of stitch markers that were notable that I used and that you have not seen. This one, I actually just found this on the ground in a little baggie, but it's beautiful. And this one was from Lone Larch Studio. And this one is from Carolyn of the Next Beautiful Thing podcast and says, cleverly disguised as a responsible adult. And it makes me really happy. So that is the progress that I have made on this side of my scrap blanket. And those of you that have been waiting on the scrap blanket tutorials, I will get there, I promise. I've only got 2 left. Whew. But I'm not even thinking about it right now. To be brutally honest with you, I'm just kind of pretending that I don't have to worry about it. Because life has other stuff thrown at me. I am knitting these on cubics, US 1.5s, which are a 2.5 millimeter, DPNs. Yeah. So, those are my works in progress. So next, I've got Maker of the Month. And those of you that are returning viewers know that, or that watch the Color and Life podcast, know that the Color and Life podcast is showcasing a different maker every month. And I, in my sort of stash love sense, have decided to support the maker of the month every month. And that's sort of my excuse to pamper myself. So for February, they had Retold Yarns by Megan, and that's her card, and she does a lot of unique yarns. It's lots of one-of-a-kinds, and they're all, or mostly, inspired by really fantastic books or movies. So this one is a sock yarn, 75% superwash, 25% nylon. It's 92 yards, or 460 yards total, for these 5 minis. And it goes from this sort of deep purple to this, I guess, like a caramel color. And the colorway is, yay, I'm a llama again! Which I love. And if you know where that's from, that makes me happy as well. So this is a gradient set. I've got a couple of different options for what I'm going to do with this gradient set. It depends on what I find as a coordinating color to go with it. And you know, it'll look differently in each of the different patterns that I have, but I just wanted to show that to you guys because it is gorgeous. Okay, and the next segment is my help segment. And for today's help segment, I want to know, what do you guys do with things that are accidentally felted? So, I've got this bag, which was my first attempt at felting, my first attempt at color work. It was a disaster, absolute disaster, on an epic proportion. And I've just been cutting it into little bits, because somebody told me you could cut it into little pieces and then let the birds use it. the birds haven't really been taking it. I don't really know what else to do with it. And then I also have these socks that I made for my husband before I knew what good yarn was, that was feltable, and I didn't realize that. I mean, this is Sweet Georgia, I think. No. This is Madeline Tosh. Actually, this is a mini of the original yarn. And it is Mad Tosh, Tosh Marina Light, Stephen Loves Tosh colorway, which is single ply, and it is not super wash, and I stupidly ran it through the wash. And he kept wearing them, and it just didn't work. Like, this is the heel flap, okay? And you can see that there's holes in it, and that's because that's where he always gets his holes first, on the bottom of his heel. He was wearing it, it's like this was the heel. It was, they were not, it was not good. So, I don't know what to do with these. They were really nice when I first made them, but now they're very small. And if anybody has any suggestions for what to do with accidentally felted work, or in the case of the bag, screwed up felted work, please let me know. Because I would appreciate doing something with them. Yeah! So, next up is a non-knitting craft, which for today is some soap. So this is some soap that I've made recently. It is made with 40% coconut oil and 60% olive oil. I did it hot process in the crock pot, and it does use lye, which is neutralized. This is one of my favorite soaps that I've made to date because it's a lot more solid than some of my previous soaps. I've been looking into the chemistry of which oils make the soap come out, how. I put tangerine essential oil in there, but you can't smell it at all. It just smells like soap. Like good soap. It smells like natural soap, but it just smells like soap. So these are, I actually got like a soap block slicer that I've been using for the first time, which made them all nice and neat on the edges. Ooh, look at that. So these are all sitting on top of this, and they are airing out. If you ever get handmade soap, it's best to let it just sit in a cool, dry is most important, preferably with drafts, area until you use it, because the longer it sits, the better it is. Okay, and at this point, I'm going to move on to my sort of topic about prattle. So, if that's all, goodbye. But my prattle for today is about clutter and what you do with clutter as a crafter. So as most of you know, you've all been there, you've all experienced the fact that you just get stuff when you craft, when you're an artist that uses a physical medium. And I have a lot of it. And one of the things that happened that was incredibly stressful near the start of the year was we discovered near the end of January that Bodhi, our lovely, lovely cat, had fleas. And I don't remember if I mentioned this in a previous prattle section, but I have no idea how he got the fleas. He's an indoor-only cat, and he's the only cat that we have, and whatever. But he takes flea medication now. He has FIV, which is basically HIV, but for cats. So that means he does have a compromised immune system, and he was not doing well. So he sleeps under the bed on top of basically all of our storage for clothes, and so we had to clean everything. We ended up, gosh, we took the mattress off to clean under the bed, and the bottom of the mattress was like ripped, so that meant that we had to get a new mattress. So then we had to get a new mattress, and they took away the old one, and there was like 3 days when we were sleeping on the couch because of it. And, because, you know, of time differences for taking them and getting them. And so we vacuumed, we, like, turbo cleaned everything, we took everything out from under the bed, and at this point I realized how much, the ridiculous amount of unnecessary stuff that I had. So I've just been going, like, nothing has been going back under the bed until I've gone through it. And I think we've taken, at this point, like, 6 garbage bags to the thrift store. Ooh. And I grew up in a household with an individual in my household who shall remain unnamed, had essentially a barely controlled hoarding problem. And it wasn't until I went to college that I realized that that's not normal behavior from everybody. And I still have guilt every time I get rid of something. Like, sorry about that, my phone battery died. Oh goodness, now I have to remember where I was. So, just in case I didn't mention it in the previous section, I don't know what I did or didn't mention. For instance, I have saved every glass jar that we've ever gotten jelly or, you know, tartar sauce or whatever in. And they're all sitting under my kitchen sink, washed and clean, ready to go. And my husband and I had this conversation, and basically we talked about, his thing was, you need to get rid of those. There's no way we're going to use that many jars. And I got rid of more than half of them, and yet I still have about 20 sitting under my kitchen sink. And, you know, if we ever need one, right, it's not like I can't go to the thrift store and spend 50 cents and get a glass jar, and yet somehow in my head, I'm screwing everything up if I don't keep them, and like it's my fault and I should feel guilty about it. And, you know, this whole stash thing and not wanting to put the shame with acquiring a stash, this whole hoarding thing is really part of why I'm trying to get my stash down, because I don't have room for it because I keep all of this other stuff. And, you know, part of it is as I'm making room for things in my closet, I'm allowing myself to have that room for yarn. But right now, I mean, I have two closets full of yarn, and we got these shelves, and I have one for knitting and one for sewing. And, you know, I want to get myself down so that I only have one closet for crafting, and then, you know, as my reward for getting rid of other stuff and taking those garbage bags to the thrift store, then I can get more yarn or have more yarn room or something. But, like, right now, it's incredibly stressful even just to live here because, like, I don't have room for my yarn. And so it's just all over the floor and I have to step across it. And it's not like I'm ashamed of my stash. I don't have a humongous stash, and I don't have a tiny stash. I have a decent-sized stash. But it's all stuff that I know what I'm going to use, and that I'm not upset that I bought. And I don't want to feel this shame over getting high-quality materials for myself as an artist. And, I mean, that's really what it is. I'm getting materials for my art, and I don't want to feel ashamed of that. And yet I don't have room. And, you know, my friend is doing her thesis in psychology on hoarding, and she's found that crafting and hoarding overlap. Like, people who do one tend to do the other more than, you know, more than what is statistically probable. And so, like, this is not something that I'm proud of, right? Like, I don't like having to come on here and saying, like, I can't control all my crap, right? Like, that's not what you're supposed to do, right? I'm supposed to pretend like my life is Pinterest, and it's not. And I bet there's a lot of you out there that also have this issue, because it is so common. And so I guess I don't want to pretend like it's not a thing. And I want to know, like, what do you do? How do you handle this? Do you guys have any techniques for getting rid of stuff? How do you organize things? What do you justify, and what do you just get rid of? Like, I'm sure I'm not the only one. I'm sure I'm not. And, I mean, someone please just comment on YouTube or in Ravelry and tell me I'm not the only one. Let me know. Let me know if you also struggle with this. Let me know if you have any techniques, if this resonates with you, or if not, or whatever, but just let me know. I don't want to come across as being ashamed of my stash. Because I'm not. I have a good stash. And it's not frivolous. But it's good. And I like it. And I'm happy with everything in it. And I don't want to create that cycle of shame that somehow you have to, like, go on a yarn diet. Like, a diet is, like, a body-shaming thing, so, like, it's a yarn-shaming thing. I don't know. But at the same time, I need to get my crap together. Like, so, yeah, if you have any thoughts, any comments, any suggestions, please, please let me know. Ravelry Thread, YouTube, whatever it is. I'm sure I'm not the only one. I'm sure I'm not. I'm trusting that I'm not. All right. Well, on that note, I'm going to head out. Thank you guys for stopping by. I hope that you enjoyed it. Have a fantabulous morning or evening or afternoon or whatever it is for you. And happy knitting, happy crafting, happy stitching. And I'll see you later. Bye.